Hi friends, I'm Anand. I wanted to share my views on various spiritual concepts. So let us talk about, I wanted to just share my views on the spirituality as a concept itself. So generally there's a perception that spirituality is something, there is an opinion that spirituality is only meant for discussions somewhere in an ashram, or when you're all your responsibilities are done, and post-retirement, things like that. But it is not. Spirituality is something which is required to be used in our daily life, which can be applied in our daily life, and we can make use of it. So let us see how it is so. So it can be applied to solve our day-to-day daily life problems. In fact, it is required even for a young boy or a young adult before even stepping into his life to take care of all his responsibilities. Hi friends, I'm Anand. I wanted to share my views on various spiritual concepts. Spirituality is generally kind of seen as something which is to be discussed in some ashram, or something when you are done with all your responsibilities, post-retirement type of stuff. But actually it is not. Spirituality is something which is required, which is to be applied in our daily life, which can be used to solve our daily life problems. That's how it is. Let us see how it is useful. So in fact, it is useful for even a young adult before stepping into his life, before taking on his responsibilities, to address or to handle these things better. That's the whole point. We don't need to connect this spirituality with any religion, God, or any other spiritual concepts or gurus. So what I'm going to talk about is a simple scientific fact which we can apply, and we can test it out and experiment within ourselves. If we simply approach this concept with an open mind, we will be able to see and understand how it works. Let us see what are the instruments we have. First of all, we have only body and mind with us, right? So using body, we can perform our external actions, and using mind, which is used for thinking and planning and so many other things, right? Let us now consider an example, okay? Say somebody has failed in an exam. He has written an exam and he failed in that attempt, okay? So if you see, if you take this example, two people will not react the same way, right? One person can take it in an easy manner, and even though he failed, he may start looking at alternate options. He may consider alternate options like either reappearing for the exam, or going for additional tuition and so many other things, right? And another person for the same incident may not take it in the same way. He may consider this as a great tragic loss in his life, and he may even attempt some some unexpected tragic situations like suicide and things like that. So that's how people take it, right? Nobody takes it in the same way. So if you see, there are two aspects to this. One is the external problem itself. How to handle that external problem is one aspect. The other aspect is the reaction, the emotional reactions which are triggered by this external event, right? If you see the external action itself, so it is relatively simple to handle an external action because the options are limited. For example, if you take in this case of a failure in exam, so there are two aspects to this problem, right? One is the external event itself. How to handle that event is one thing. So, but if you see, other problem is the emotions that get triggered because of this external event, which is a sorrow. It may cause a sorrow or pain or any kind of emotion, right? Depending on the situation. So if you see, handling the external event is relatively simpler because the options are limited. So if you take in this example, you can either go for a tuition, reappear in the exam, or look for an alternate course, or start a business or whatever, right? So those are the limited options. Even if you are not aware, you can always take the advice from your parents, relatives, or friends. Somebody will be able to suggest. That's a simpler part of the problem. But the most difficult part of the problem is the emotions, because moment we there is a pain or sorrow which gets created in us, we immediately naturally tend to resist that, right? Because nobody likes this emotions, these negative emotions like sorrow and pain. So the problem is, the challenge is more in handling this psychological state of mind, the emotions which get created in us, right? So naturally, whenever there is a negative emotion of sorrow or pain, we tend to resist that. We immediately want to get rid of that situation somehow, and you know, we start fighting against it. We want to somehow push that and, you know, push that out of our mind. That's the natural reaction, right? So we immediately start fighting against it. So our entire focus shifts, or you know, sits in handling this emotion which is happening inside, and we do not know how to handle, because the moment you start fighting against it, again the problem becomes complex, and you know, you don't know what to do in the external world, you get confused. So the whole balanced state of mind, the balance, you lose that balanced state, right? Then you don't know what to do in the external world, what action to be taken, because you are in a confused state. And you don't know what to do in the internal, this psychological system. So you're kind of dealing with both of these in a haphazard manner. You don't know what to do where, you know, what role you can play in the internal system and what can you do in the external system. So this kind of, this haphazard manner of handling the situation causes the whole confusion, right? Okay. So why is this happening? Let's understand. So because we're not able to handle this instrument, we don't have an idea of about how to handle this instrument of body and mind. Where can we play a role, and where do we have a role to play, and you know, what can be done, etc. So once we understand this functioning of these instruments which we carry, which is called body and mind, then we will be able to handle this in an efficient manner. We'll be able to handle the situation with a well-balanced state of mind. So that's the whole objective of this, right? Let's get into the details and see how do we understand this further. Okay, thank you.
Hi everyone, this is Babulal. I want to share my opinion on information which is going to be helpful to you. Every one of us likes to do the work better and better like that. For this purpose, we acquire latest knowledge, information, technology and equipments, machineries, etc. Despite of all these knowledges, still we find some gaps at some time. That is mainly because of the emotional backgrounds. Okay, sometimes we feel that I got tension, I got fear, etc. Hence, I could not be able to do the work in a better way. So this is a common factor for all the people to have a negative emotion and had an impact on the work is concerned. If that is so, how do we improve on our work? That becomes an important parameter. Okay, now if you have to look at on this work is concerned, primarily we do by our physical body and our mental body. Physical body remains same at a given point of time and situation. The mental body varies with respect to situation, with respect to mood, and with respect to nature. The impact from this mental body makes a variation in our work. So our now focus on to look at the mental body. So the improvement on the mental body leads for a better environment and better situation to improve our work. So in order to improve on the mental body, first we have to understand the mental body is concerned. So we need to analyze what mental body is and how we can improve on that. Mental body, we generally call it as mind. The mind can be divided into two parts based on this function. It is not going to be difficult analysis. We don't need any special knowledge, any medical knowledge, etc. It is ordinary functional value which anybody can understand. Now, this mind is divided into two parts. One is called conscious mind, another is called subconscious mind. The conscious mind primarily consists of intellect, ably supported by memory. Now, what does this intellect do? The intellect takes a decision at any given point of time, which we take the job. So, apart from taking a decision, it takes the help from the memory, where the datas and informations, etc., available there, and depending upon the situation, it applies there and wins over the decisions. That means it tries to acquire the situation and wins over it. That is the prime work of intellect is concerned. During this process of doing any work, if some knowledge or some information, if it is missing, it acquires, it understands, and it acquires, understands to effectively complete the job. That means it has got a basic characteristic of winning the situation as well as by understanding it, also improve that decision also. So this is the characteristic of our intellect is concerned. Now let us come to another portion of it, which is subconscious mind. Subconscious mind, which is primarily of giving emotions. All our emotions are coming out from the subconscious mind. Say, we get angry, we get happiness, we get sorrow, anything and everything of emotions, negative or positive, anything maybe, it comes out of this area. The characteristic of this area is you cannot control this area. It throws away the emotions based on the nature of a person and the situation outside it is concerned, primarily. Now, you can take an example. Suppose you want to be in angry mood throughout the day. Is it possible? Definitely, it is not possible by anyone. That means to say that this conscious mind, subconscious mind, cannot be controlled by anybody else. So these are the two parameters with which we are executing our work. Having seen what is mind, let us get into how we do the work with this and what problem it comes in. Say we are doing some work. During that work, we get into problem, we get, say, one unhappy situation. When the situation arises, a fear comes, rather angry comes, because of the situation is concerned. Now, how do we deal the situation is the question. Now, the work is done by intellect, as we have seen in the past. Now, the intellect has to win the situation, and this fear, no, does not support to him. So it tries to kill that fear because it does not like the fear. It enjoys only the happiness. So once it does not like, it tries to attack on that. One side of the subconscious mind, it always releases, it cannot be controlled. And another side, the intellect, it tries to stop it. That means the mind is split into two parts. One starts working against the other. So then how can it be successful? The mind which has to work totally outside the work for a challenge. It is split into two and then fight among by itself. In that case, the efficiency, the ability to do a better way, obviously comes down. Now, this is a common parameter that everybody is getting into. Now, how do we solve or how do we come out of this situation is the important question. As we have seen that intellect, who is the doer of the work, who decides the work, who plays an important role for doing the work, acquires some knowledge, understands some knowledge, it does the work. Now, under these circumstances where we is failing, can we give some information, some knowledge to intellect so that we can come out of this situation? This is the prime idea about this current requirement. Have you seen all the flows, like what is mental body, physical body, what the mental body consists of, what is the typical problem of this, how the mind is divided into two parts. Now, how are you going to make use of this intellect and this current situation? The solution seems to be improve or make intellect to work along with the situation. Now, the intellect needs an understanding. The understanding is such, the emotion which are coming up is a continuous one. We have seen that time, the period which lives is very, very short. It is much, much, much lesser than a second. And this emotion, by that life, it dies. And it flows by itself. So this is the basic information to be given in intellect. Once this information is given to that intellect, it understands that we need not fight against what is not there, that means which is flowing away. Once it understands, the intellect understands that portion of it, then intellect would like to or start focusing on the outside work only. Once intellect starts focusing on the outside work, then it need not fight inside. Once it does not fight inside, the mind as a whole part starts working towards outside. When the mind starts working as full unit, then the result what we get is good. That means every time the break will not be there, we will be able to do better and better. So this is the core knowledge that we have to get. In short, the knowledge which is missing to intellect has to be given. The knowledge is such, the life of the emotion is hardly much less than a second, which dies by itself, and you cannot control over that. So this understanding that intellect cannot control the emotions. In spiritual parlance, it is called enlightenment. Once the flow starts taking place without any resistance, it is called liberation. Anyway, these spiritual words we need not bother about. We are concerned about only how do we perform the work better. Now we have seen how we can do the work better. Basically, what is happening is we are not allowing the mind to get split. And once the mind does not get split as a single unit, it does the better work. And day by day, with the full creativity, it improves. Thank you for all.
Hi. Now let us understand what is mind and how it functions. Right. So I'm going to talk about my own experience and what I saw inside when I experimented inside. It is not derived from theories from any books or videos. So let us look at how it practically functions. Okay. So what is mind? Is this something you can locate it physically? No, right? You cannot see this. So we can call mind as a collection of thoughts, right? A continuous flow of thoughts, a stream of thoughts flowing every moment. So we have just given the name, this continuous flow of thoughts, as mind, right? Let us see how thoughts flow. So if you imagine, if you're standing in a platform in a railway station, the train, you know, compartment by compartment, it passes through the platform, right? So if you see, if you carefully observe, that is how the thoughts also flow in our system. And the important point to note is, your attention span is only one, right? At a given point of time, you will be able to attend to only one thought at a time. You will not be able to attend to two thoughts at a given point of time. So the attention span is limited to only one thought at a time. So now let us see how this functions in real life. If you closely observe, there is space only for one thought at a time, right? So, but because of our memory, we get a feeling that there is a thought which is constantly sitting inside. So if you see, if you have seen this in the movie theater, like pictures running with multiple frames, like 24 or 30 frames per second, you know, there will be running frames of clips, which will give you a feeling that you're seeing a continuous, a still picture or a movie, a motion picture, right? But it is individual frames of clips of scenes. So similarly, the thoughts, it is a continuous flow. It is not one thought sitting inside and waiting for you to push them out or waiting for you to retain it, right? It is just a continuous flow of thoughts. But using our memory, because of our memory, we think that there is a thought sitting inside, right? Now let us assume a feeling or an emotion of sorrow or pain occurs in you, right? So now that occurs, and the moment you think that you want to get rid of this pain or sorrow, so the actual sorrow has already passed you, because thoughts are flowing in a sequential manner, one by one. So a sorrow comes, and the moment you think that you have to get rid of the sorrow, that actual sorrow or pain is already passed your attention, right? But we don't realize that. We kind of start fighting immediately as we see sorrow. Immediately we start, our natural reaction, our natural tendency is to start resisting against it, and we start fighting against it. So fighting here means it's not a physical fight, right? There is a thought coming, and you do not want that thought. You oppose that. So it's a clash which is happening. So because of this, you constantly remember that same sorrow again and again, and relive that same sorrow and pain again and again, and start fighting over it. That's what is happening. And similarly, let us assume a positive emotion enters in you, right? The moment you think that you want to retain that emotion permanently, that positive emotion is already past you, because that compartment is already passed. But now you are thinking about, you want to retain the positive emotion. So that then again the fight starts, because the positive emotion is already gone, you are missing that. So the fight again starts. So you again try to retain, because the naturally it is already passed, but you kind of try to start fighting against it to retain somehow permanently, right? So this kind of all these kind of negative and positive emotions trigger a kind of continuous sort of struggle or conflicts in our mind. So this leads to all kind of struggle and conflicts. But if we clearly understand, if we kind of test it out ourselves, that this is the natural flow of mind, this is how the thoughts are flowing, then we will be able to handle this instrument in a better way. That's the whole objective. So then if you are able to handle this in a better way, we will be able to. So if you understand that this is the natural flow of mind, and if you allow it to flow freely without interrupting the natural flow, then all your psychological imbalance or the struggles and conflicts will get cleared. Then you will be completely, you know, you will be able to get rid of the emotional problems and the struggles that are happening inside, and you will be able to act in a well-balanced manner, in an efficient manner. You will be able to perform your tasks in an efficient way, and that's what our objective is, right? So let's see the rest of some other details in the next video. Let's see how we can function in the external world, and how the mind helps us in doing that, and what is the relation, how do we handle an external task, how do we handle the emotions and all that in detail in the subsequent sessions. Thank you. Hi. So we kind of discussed about allowing the mind or thoughts to flow freely, right? So let us understand in detail what is this allowing actually. So this allowing a free flow of mind is not an action that needs to be performed. You have to understand this clearly, right? Because if you consider this as an action, then again you're just shifting the problem, you're just giving the problem a different name. Let us see how it happens. So earlier you were kind of fighting against all your negative emotions, you wanted to get rid of that immediately, and you were kind of wanted to retain the positive emotions permanently. So that was the fight which was going on. Now that you've understood that allowing is the right choice to do, now you're just shifting the problem to a different scale. Now you've come to the conclusion that allowing a problem or allowing the thoughts to flow freely is the right action to do, not allowing is the wrong action, right? So now again the confusion or the struggle will start. Whenever you're able to allow, you're happy and you will again want to retain that same moment again and again. Whenever you're not able to allow, you feel that pain or sorrow and you again want to reject that. So the problem is just getting shifted, it's not getting resolved. So that's what we have to understand here. So now, instead of an external event making you happy or sad, your own internal decision of allowing or not allowing is causing pain to you. That's what we have seen, right? So because of this decision by our intellect, so a conscious action to allow will not help solve the problem. So the only option left is to understand this whole phenomena, understand this whole structure of mind, how it functions. That's the only solution. You must have heard that time heals everything. So let us see why it is so. Because if you have to put up a fight, you need a lot of energy, right? All your energy will get drained. Whenever there is a pain and you're resisting it, it needs a lot of energy. You will be completely drained after some time. So you will not be able to put up a fight beyond a certain point of time. Of course, depending on the seriousness of the situation, the impact, you will really get tired after some time, right? You will not be able to continue fighting. How long you will fight? It could be for, 1 hour, 2 hours, 1 day or 1 week. Beyond a point, you have to allow it to flow. You will not have the energy. You will become tired and you will have to allow it to flow. So once you allow that to flow, once your grip loosens, obviously those thoughts or the emotions start flowing. And that's how time, heals everything, right? But the problem with this is not a conscious action. This is not a decision that we've made. This happens without your control, without your knowledge. But the problem is this allowing it to flow freely happens without your knowledge and control, right? So by the time you would have reacted in a haphazard manner, you would not have acted, or you would have missed acting in the external world. So because you don't have any control, you just start fighting against all the emotions, and after some time you get tired and your grip loosens and it starts flowing freely. But we understand the concept. If we are able to understand how it functions, we can do this with our own control, with completely in a conscious manner, right? We don't have to depend, or we can act in a better way. So if you can understand the functionality of mind in a detailed manner, then you will understand that you don't need to struggle or start fighting with these emotions. So once you understand that, then your whole mental system will be in a healthy or well-balanced state. If you are in a well-balanced state, obviously you will be able to handle your external activities in a much better way. That's what we wanted to do, right? So let us understand this further in the next videos. Thank you. Hi. So we saw that if we allow the entire the psychological system, the thoughts to flow freely on its own, we saw that we get into a balanced state of mind, right? So if we understand that this whole structure of the flow of thoughts, if we allow it to flow freely as a natural, like a river, a stream of water, without any interruption or struggle from our side, then things flow easily on its own, right? This makes the entire psychological system becomes very light. And when it is really light, the problem or the impact of the external incident doesn't weigh on us. So we are able to handle the external problem in an effective manner. Even if there is an external incident which causes pain in us, the effect of that or the impact of that will be negligible for us, so that we'll be able to handle that in a better manner. As you know, there is a saying that a rolling stone gathers no mass, right? So when the thoughts flow freely, it doesn't impact us. The impact, or the intensity of impact, is very less because it's just flowing very freely. It is not stuck. So if the impact is less, then the whole system, the psychological system, is in a well-balanced state. So which leads us to handle our external actions in a much better and efficient way. So this is what is actually, in Tamil, we also call this as sumairu. And we can also term this as surrender. So here what I'm doing is, we're understanding the natural flow or the functioning of mind and surrendering our urge to control the flow, either the negative emotions, either rejecting the negative emotions or retaining the positive emotions. We're rejecting this. We are ignoring this urge to control the flow of thoughts, right? So we are surrendering that urge to the mind. So here, if you see, even there is any wrong or a bad thought, is like writing your name on the water, for example, right? And even if you make a spelling mistake, it doesn't matter because it would have already got erased and you have to write it again. So that's what happens. As we already saw, thoughts are like a train, compartment of the train passing through in a platform. So every thought passes one by one. And when a thought is already passed, when you already think about retaining a thought or rejecting a thought, the previous thought has already passed. So you don't have anything to do with that previous thought. So we already saw that. So I'm sure you will agree that the difference between a well-balanced state of mind handling an external action or a mind which is stuck with psychological emotions and kind of heavily weighed down with psychological emotions, you will not be able to act in an efficient manner. So that is the problem we are trying to resolve here. Once we are totally free inside, we will be able to handle all our external problems in a much better way. So let us get into more details and understand how does this mind function? What are the various things that we can do and what we cannot do, right? So let us see, can we create a thought as per our wish? Can we create any thought that we want? No, right? Because the circumstances, depending on the situation, thoughts flow in on its own, right? Or can we even reject it? Can we remove any thoughts, you know, as per our wish? No, we cannot. Because if we try to remove, it only gets strengthened. Because we are again reliving that same thought and again and again. We already saw that every thought is like passing like a compartment of a train. If you start fighting against it, then you're reliving that thought again and again. So you'll not be able to remove. Or can you retain a thought as much as you want in terms of the duration? Can I retain a thought for 1 hour, 2 hour? No, you will not be able to, because your mind will be always wandering. Right? You will not be able to do that. Or can I slow down a thought? Can I slow down the appearance of any thought? No, because thought comes instantly depending on the circumstances. We will not be able to do that, right? Or can you create a more intense, powerful thought or a less intense, powerful thought, depending on the situation, depending on the need of the situation? No, again, because only after it comes, only we understand the intensity and impact. So all these pointers that I'm giving you, you don't have to take it as an answer or as an idea from me or any other guru. You should actually test it out for yourself, because that is when you will be able to understand whether you're really able to do it or not, right? So when something is really not obeying your commands, or when something is not acting according to your wish list, so can you say it is under your control? No, right? So when something is not under your control, after you do all these experiments, so can you really take the responsibility of correcting it or purifying your mind or purifying your thoughts as per your wish? No, that is not possible, because anyway, it is not under your responsibility. You cannot do anything with that. That's what we've already seen. So if you cannot control something, then obviously you cannot take responsibility of correcting it as well. So whatever actions we tend to take, either to correct or purify or whatever you want to do, is only another thought, right? So you will only start fighting against your own, because first of all you got a thought or emotion, say a sorrow or pain. Now you want to correct it, is another thought. So thought versus, it's like thought versus thought fighting. So basically you are fighting against yourself, so it can never end. You are fighting against your own. That's the problem, right? So here the fight is, it's not a physical fight as we already explained. It is a, there is one thought and there is an opposing thought which clashes against each other. So it clashes and you're getting into a continuous struggle or conflict inside. That's the whole problem. So any attempt, any conscious attempt to control will only result in failure. So just to talk about this conscious effort. So let us say there is some happy event happening. You're having a happy moment and there is some sad event happening. Then it creates pain, right? So now we have come to a conclusion that I should not control any of these thoughts. So that is what you've decided. But if you come to a conscious conclusion, what happens is you're just doing a name transfer. The situation is not changing. Let's see how it is. So there is a happy moment, you're becoming happy. There is a painful moment, you're becoming pain. Now you decided that I will not control these thoughts. So now what happens is, sorry, when I'm not able to control my thoughts, that becomes a happy moment. When I try to control or when I start controlling, that becomes a sad moment. So essentially only the name has changed. You have changed happy to no control, sad to control. But the situation remains the same. So you'll again be circling within the same loop. So the problem is you cannot take a conscious. So the whole objective is you cannot make a conscious decision to accept it. There is no action involved in accepting or allowing it to flow freely. It is an understanding. You have to understand the whole structure of mind. And because of that understanding, the allowing of this free flowing of thoughts will happen as an outcome. That's how it should happen. Let us get that, understand that in detail. So once you understand this whole structure of mind, then you will be completely free from all psychological struggles and you will be able to act in the external world in an efficient manner, which we already saw. But now the question will be, if we allow thoughts to flow freely or if we ignore all these emotions, how do we act in the external world will be the question, right? So we will address that in the subsequent video. Thank you. Hi. So we keep hearing this question in the spiritual world called, who am I? A lot of people come across this question and a lot of people want to know, who am I? But actually speaking, any question, it has to be a genuine question from inside. Otherwise it will not have any value. The whole purpose of this question is to experiment or interrogate yourself inside and understand what it means. That's the whole purpose. The question is irrelevant, right? So it should not be like you've read this question from some books or some guru has said that because of that, if you want to understand who am I, then it will not have any value because you will just look at it in an academic way. You'll just questioning from your knowledge. That's not going to help. The purpose of that question is drill down, dive down inside, dive deep inside and understand the functioning of your whole system. That is the objective, not just asking this question at a superficial level. So only a genuine question will have a value. So for example, just I'm taking my example. So who am I was not my question. My question was, like for example, I kept searching across various concepts, various paths. I was never satisfied. I was just hopping from one system to another system. You know, Ramakrishna, Osho, and so many others, right? So at one point it struck like, what do I want? What am I actually looking for? So that was my genuine question, not who am I. I was not worried about who am I. I was more interested in what am I looking for actually? What am I trying to seek? Why am I not satisfied? Those were my questions. So if you go deep into yourself and understand your genuine question, then that will have value. Then it will lead you to the answer. Because if you keep on asking that question, the genuine question within yourself and try to find out the answer, that will lead you to a solution. That should be the objective. So how it helps is, so like for example, I was asking, what do I want? It only helps me to remove all the other unwanted or the superficial questions and allow me to focus on the root of the problem. That's how it helps, because I was going through various paths, so I was not satisfied with the answers I was getting. So naturally the question was, what do I want then, and why am I not satisfied? What is the problem that I'm trying to address? Those were the questions. So it helped me to focus onto the problem statement, so that which can easily lead to the solution, right? So then I understood that the problem is my mind is not acting as per my wish. So all these questions led me to the conclusion that my mind is not acting as per my wish. So then that becomes my problem statement. So then I started inquiring, what is mind, what is the functionality of mind, how does it work, why is it not under my control? So I started inquiring all that. So which led me to inquiring this whole system and understanding this whole system called mind. So once this understanding happens, once you understand this complete functionality of mind, then you will come to know what can be done, what is your role, where can you play your role, what are the do's and don'ts, basically, where you cannot do anything, where can you play a role, how it reflects in the external world, and how external world situation reflects in your mind. So once you understand this completely, then all these psychological conflicts and struggles will drop down on its own, because all these are created by us, right? Because of the misunderstanding we had, which we already saw in the previous video. So I will suggest or encourage you to ponder on your genuine question that you have, rather than taking up a question from some book or some video. So understand and take up the genuine question that you have in your mind, and try to find a solution or try to find an answer to that. That will help you in reaching to a conclusion. Thank you. Okay, right. So we already saw that we should allow the free flow of thoughts and ignore this. We don't need to interrupt this whole system. But the question will be, how do we act in the external world? That could be a question which will come up, right? Let us see, how do we handle our external tasks? What happens exactly? So we are not actually asking you to stop thinking or ignore your thinking process. Because let us see how external task happens, then you can understand that in a clear way. So this process is, we are only asking you to see how it functions. We are not ignoring the thinking process, right? Let us say you have an interest in becoming a cricket player, or interest in music. So then obviously, only that interest will drive you to work towards practicing cricket or practicing music, etc., right? So that drive is needed. Whatever is the thought or the desire or the interest in music, only that will drive you to actions, right? So interest is just another form of thought, right? So you are thinking, there is a thought which comes, which attracts you, so you are more interested in that than the external task. So without the thoughts, so action is not possible, because only those thoughts will have to drive you. Because if there are no thoughts, then you will not be able to act in the external world, right? So even negative thoughts, like even a tension or a worry or anxiety, is only helpful in the external world, right? For example, if you are driving a car, for example, then you will only if there is a feeling, or if there is a kind of cautious approach, then you will be able to drive cautiously. But if you don't have any kind of fear or hesitation, then you will be driving haphazardly, right? Because you don't care about what happens. So all these emotions are only helping us to act cautiously, to act in a civilized manner, for example, right? Or we can also take up an example of running a business, right? If you are completely positive about it, then you will go all out aggressive. You will not be thinking about any negative situations or anything that can happen, right? So then if you go all out aggressive, then situation may not be in your control. Anything can happen, right? But if there is a worry or hesitation or some kind of anxiety or doubt that comes up, then you will take enough precautions. You will see, what are the risks involved? How do I handle if it doesn't go well? You will start doing all the risk mitigation, look at all the risk mitigation options, and be able to plan well and be able to execute your task in a much better way. So all this worry or anxiety is actually helping us here, right? You'll be able to perform your actions in a much better, in a complete manner. Without that, probably you would have just gone blind aggressive, which is not our objective here, right? A simple blind aggression is not going to help. Rather than that, a thought through planned action will be more helpful, because you will be in a balanced state of mind. You know what are the risks involved, what are the negative options possible. You'll be able to think through the complete result, you know, complete possible results, and you'll be able to plan accordingly. So that is the use of this. Otherwise, if there is no such worry or anxiety, even for example, if you take up writing an exam, if you don't have any fear or anxiety or tension about writing the exam, you will just be lazy and keep postponing your preparation every day, right? Because you're not cared whether you will pass or not. But if there is a worry or anxiety which is there in your mind, which will drive you, so then you would like to work hard, you would like to complete it give your best effort, you would like to complete it in the best way, so you will start preparing it in a better way. That's the use of this. But of course, when there is no action needed in the external world, then any kind of worry or anxiety or any psychological emotion, we can simply allow it to pass, which we already saw that it is already passing. We just have to remain quiet and not disturb the entire flow. So only the psychological world, you know, has all these emotions. We are talking about allowing it to flow, a natural free flow of mind, right? We are talking about that. But if you look at the society, the external world, it is all made up by us. It's not a natural process. It's an artificial arrangement, a convenient arrangement we have arranged for ourselves to ensure that everybody gets equal rights and, you know, nobody, we are not hurting others. So that is the whole objective. So there you have to play by the rules and regulations, because that is what we have already agreed. That is the agreement we have already made between among ourselves, you know, that we all have to live in this manner. So according to the rules and regulations of that society where we live. So that is definitely required in the external world. So only in the psychological system you can allow it to flow in its natural flow, right? That's what we said. Thank you. So how does the external world understand us? They will not be able to understand your thoughts, right? Only your action or your speech can be reachable to the external world. They will not understand anything else, right? So since we've already understood the functional arrangement of this psychological system, we've already agreed and come to a conclusion that we should allow it freely. So our entire focus and energy should be only in the external world, because there is nothing that you need to do inside, is what we've already seen. So the entire action, entire focus or energy has to be transformed, has to be put in the external world. And we have to act according to the rules and regulations of the society. So obviously, if we are free inside psychologically with no struggles and conflicts, we will be able to handle our external actions in a much better way, right? And we can operate in the external world in an effective way. So that is the whole objective of this whole enlightenment that we're talking about. So we understood the whole process, we understood the function of our body and mind. The body is used for involving in the external actions, and mind is used for thinking and planning and all that. And apart from that, how the external world triggers emotions in us and how it can be handled, what can we do, what we cannot do, we saw all that, right? So finally, all this is needed for us to act in the external world in an efficient manner. That's the end result, right? There is nothing, because once you are free inside, all that we have is the external world to act. So the only role that we can do is perform the actions in a better way, right? Thank you. Okay, let us talk about acceptance. So acceptance is not something that we take a conscious decision to accept. Acceptance is something which has to happen on a complete wholehearted manner, right? It's not like holding a portion of mind and accepting the other portion of the mind. That's not going to work, because it's going to be again a conscious decision. You're just splitting the mind into two parts. One part again, you know, start fighting with the other. That will keep continuing. Because when you make a conscious decision, it again comes from your knowledge or mind only. So it is again mind acting against mind. The same thing will continue again and again. And of course, there are no two entities within you. So the question will be, who is accepting whom? So that kind of duality and the confusion will keep continuing. So any conscious decision to accept this whole system will only split the system into two parts, which is not going to be effective or which is not going to be helpful, because that is not the whole objective here. Whereas acceptance in totality means just remaining quiet without making any judgment. So if you're just able to remain quiet without making any judgment, then the acceptance happens on its own naturally. So that is the acceptance that we're talking about. Because a lot of people mistake this acceptance for an action, a conscious action that need to be performed in the psychological system. So if, for example, it could be even you're accepting the fact that you're not able to accept. Even that can be accepted, because you're just accepting the fact whatever is as is. If you're not able to accept your system, you should accept that also, that you're not able to accept the system. That's how it is. So as we saw, this is only a natural outcome which should happen as an outcome, as part of the understanding of the functionalities of the mind and body that we already discussed, right? So we have to go through this understanding, and once the understanding happens, this should come as an outcome. That's what we saw. And not a conscious action to be performed. Thank you.
Hello, sir.
Hi.
I have some bad habit, and I know that is bad to my health and life. But I don't have an idea how to come back to my normal life. IA principle says that when I'm conscious to leave that thought, and I can't understand that clearly. Can you please explain me that?
Yeah, sure. So let us understand how this happens. Okay. Now, initially, okay, there is a bad habit. Say, for example, let us take smoking, right? So initially, you were smoking, and you understood that smoking is a. Initially, actually, you were smoking. You were enjoying smoking. And whenever you are not smoking, you had a pain. For example, that's a negative emotion or the absence of a happiness, we can call it as, right? So that is where you were initially. So now, since you have understood that smoking is a bad habit and you have to get rid of that, now you just replace this smoking with, you have to get rid of bad habit. So whenever you are able to get rid of bad habit, that is attached to this happiness. Whenever you are not able to get rid of bad habit, there is a sorrow or absence of happiness. So what you have done here is you have just changed the names. Initially it was smoking, happiness, no smoking, no happiness. Now if I am able to control bad habits, it is happiness. If I'm not able to control bad habits, it is sorrow. So here you have not actually done anything. You have just changed the name. You have just changed the name and doing the same action again and again. So what happens here is, because once you make a conscious decision on the psychological system, because there is only one entity here inside, there are no two entities here, right? So the question comes, when you are making a decision, then the question comes as to who are you actually trying to decide, or who is deciding upon whom, because there is only one, right? So what can be done here is, so mind will again start fighting against, because smoking or bad habit is one thought, I should not have bad habits is another thought. So these two will keep clashing. So this will be a continuous clash against each other. There will be a continuous struggle. So you cannot win against your own. Mind cannot fight and win against mind itself, right? There is only one entity. So that is the whole problem. So here the solution is, you have to understand the whole structure or the functioning of the mind, how thoughts flow, what is happening. So let us see, for example, I think we already discussed. So thoughts are flowing in a sequential manner. It is not that there is a thought of some pain or sorrow. It is not that there is a whole big thought of sorrow which is sitting upon you. No, it is happening every moment, like a compartment of a train passing through a platform. Thought comes one by one every moment. It is not that one complete big ball of thought sitting, no, right? So which means what happens is, so a thought comes, you're thinking that smoking is a bad habit, smoking is a bad habit, you feel that, and the next thought immediately, I have to get rid of this smoking, whatever, right? So immediately, and you know that we have only attention span, you can only think about one thought at a given point of time, you cannot think about two thoughts. Your memory space is only sufficient for one thought at a time. So when you start thinking that you have to get rid of this problem, so the problem is already gone, because it's the compartment which is already gone. So you are in the next compartment now. So what we are doing is, you are actually again trying to fight against it. You are again trying to pull that and, you know, relive, keep it in the memory and try to relive that again and again and again and again. So you are actually, in using your memory, you are keep on fighting against it. That's what is happening. But if you allow it to flow freely, it is already gone past. I mean, it is not that you have to allow, it is already going, but you are just pulling it and trying to fight against it. That's what is happening. So the action here is to understand this is how it is flowing, this is what is happening. And so if you understand and keep quiet that you don't have any role to play in this whole psychological system, it would have already passed, and so the whole thing becomes easier. I mean, it will not weigh heavily on your psychological system. The whole impact will become much, much lesser. So when you are fighting, the whole problem becomes very complex and big, because you are fighting against your own mind. So it is like the whole pain becomes double, because you are fighting against your own mind. So two energies are fighting against each other. The whole problem itself becomes complex and maybe magnified manner. But when you understand and it flows freely, the impact of that becomes very less. So now your psychological system will be completely clear. You will not be bogged down by the action that is happening in the external world. So once your psychological system is clear, you will be able to handle things in the external world in a much better way. So which means you will be in a well-balanced state of mind, and you will be able to understand that some things are beyond your control, and that is how the flow of thoughts are happening, and then address these problems accordingly, right? Thanks.
As you said, when the mind is when the mind comes to a balance, and then the habit naturally goes out of the person. Can you please explain?
So again, if you look at the habit, you can bifurcate into two sections or two aspects of it. One is the actual act of that habit. For example, if it is smoking or whatever it is, the actual act of doing that habit. Other is the psychological aspect of it, which is psychological emotion or something that this habit brings into us. So we are more bounded. For example, an external action is happening. It is like we are connected to that, like you can call it as a switch. So any happiness or pain, an external action only triggers like a switch, but the actual pain or happiness happens only inside, right? Or you get that happiness only inside, not outside. Only the action happens in the external world. So the point is, once you are clear and thorough with this internal system, then since we are not clear now, so the problem is we kind of act in a haphazard manner. We don't know where to correct, whether to do something here or something there. We keep on doing some random actions in a haphazard manner. But once we understand this whole system, that this is why it is happening and this is what is happening in the psychological system, so then the external world is just the external action is just an action. So it will not have that much of impact. Of course, it may still continue. That's a different thing. But the impact will be much lesser. So you will be able to handle it in a much effective manner, because any action in the external situation or in the external world is only bound by the rules and regulations of that society. It is not a natural flow of thoughts or mind. So that you have to take care of the external habit based on the system that we have in process, system that we have in the society and things like that. But once you are free inside, then you will be able to, you will have that clarity to think about and decide what is beneficial for me to act in which manner. So those kind of possibilities will arise. So that's how you can address these problems.
That we may, if we are clear inside, we may not need a switch to external switch to condition our happiness or sorrow. Is that so?
I mean, again, you cannot we cannot decide that whether we need a switch or not, but it will external, any external event will start triggering some emotions anyway. I mean, you cannot help that. Any external event will start.
No, the habit.
The habit.
Again, we are going to the habit.
Yeah.
If we are not clear, we are again going to switch off the habit.
Yeah, sort of. Because since you are not clear, you are bogged down by this whole psychological emotions. So you're not able to understand, and you're not under the control. You're not under your controls, basically. So that's why you keep doing something haphazardly. Once you understand this, once the psychological process is clear, once you have the clarity, then the external actions are relatively simple. I will not say that, you know, it is, you don't have to put any effort, but the actions will be relatively easier. You will be able to handle. So the weight will come down drastically. So that's the whole point. So then you will be able to act in a sensible manner. That's all. Whatever is good for you, you will be able to handle, you will be able to do those actions. Whatever is bad for you, you will be able to try and avoid those. So, because the problem is we are attached to the psychological system. That is what is creating this whole problem. It's not the external action alone. Mm-hmm. That is my point.
A gentle question may I ask?
Yeah.
In Bhagavad Mission, do we believe in rebirth?
See, again, these points are, we can discuss about so many ideas and concepts which are about rebirth, etc. But the problem is nobody can prove or disprove. I mean, even if I give some answer, you will not be able to disprove, or I will not be able to prove also.
Why this doubt comes to me today? I'm talking about the Manolaya and Manula, Nasha. Memory is there. Memory is always there. As they say, if that awareness, memory and awareness, memory gets muted into awareness.
I'm sorry?
Memory gets muted into awareness, and it, if the child there is rebirth, the memory comes with, they call it padivugal.
Okay. Okay, you are saying as part of rebirth, memory continues.
Memory continues
with the awareness. With the awareness, okay. Yeah, I mean, there are some concepts, definitely, but the problem is, as I said, nobody can prove this or disprove this, because unless I go through that experience, I cannot prove you, or unless you go through that experience yourself, you will not be able to disprove also. So this will more like become a concept that we can keep it for handling your things in an easier way. Maybe if you think that there is a rebirth, and if it helps you in handling your external actions in an efficient manner or in a much better way, you can keep that, you know, you can stick to that opinion. There is nothing wrong with that. And if you think that that is not helping you, you can always drop it, because the fundamental point is not about all these things, right? The fundamental point is to get rid of our psychological problems. That's the whole core of the system. So once you are able to do that, so all these are external, peripheral things that you can always.
I need your guidance for a situation that I face. In my office, somebody did an unhappy work, which is not acceptable to me. So I had to fire him. I fired so much that he could not tolerate. He started even weeping from the situation. He left the situation from the office. Later on, I felt very bad, and so much that I'm feeling very guilty about it. Even after coming home the next day and subsequent day also, I'm not able to come out of the guilt. But since I have done wrong with that man, I should do something, and do something also to me, so that I should come out of the guilt. Please advise me.
Okay. So here again, you have to look at the problem in two parts. One is the actual external action that has happened. For example, you said there is a problem which he did not perform the business activity in the right manner, and you were unhappy with the action that he performed. So in the business, in the external world, So obviously you have to be objective. You cannot be emotional about the business aspect of it. If there is a, if your company, I mean, if your policy is that if there is an unhappy work is done, you have to fire him, then that's the right action. Maybe you can re-evaluate if it needs a firing, or maybe if a lesser form of punishment is sufficient. So that's a different thing. But some punishment is required, which is definitely, that is the objective of doing business. Because otherwise, if you are lenient and if you are allowing everything to happen, then obviously you will not be able to run the business in an efficient way. So that is perfectly correct. There is nothing wrong in it. But as I said, you can always reevaluate and see if you can give a lesser form of punishment. So that is there. The second thing is, the guilt comes because you feel that maybe you have spoiled his career or whatever, right? So again, as I said, the objective part or the business aspect, you have to keep it out. But the guilt happens inside. But the problem here is the action has already happened. So when the action has already happened, it is irreversible. So whatever you do, it is not going to, you cannot reverse that again. But of course, you have choice to do some remedial actions. You can try to correct it and all that. But in the psychological system, there is nothing you can do, because whatever guilt or any emotion that happens is just a trigger because of the external event which has occurred. So because since you have an idea that firing somebody, maybe you have an idea that firing somebody is a wrong action, so that actually has triggered the guilt in you. So that's the right effect, in fact. If somebody has an idea of that this action is wrong, then that doing that action will definitely trigger a guilt in anybody, for that matter. So that's the right reaction your mind produces. So now you can react based on. So for the guilt, you cannot do anything, because that's the right reaction that the mind has produced. There is nothing wrong in that. So the only action that you can take is the remedial action that is possible in the external world, now that the action has already happened, or reevaluate the kind of extent of punishment can be given to that person. So that's the only solution I can think of.
How long that guilt will be with me? A month or two? How is it?
Okay. I mean, obviously, we cannot give a prescribed time for that. But once we understand the flow of thoughts, as we already described or saw, because every thought flows like in sequence, right? Because you can attend to, you have only mind space to attend to only one thought at a given point of time. So the moment you think another thought, the previous thought has already passed your attention. So that's how it flows one by one. So once you understand this whole process, because it's already flowing in a natural flow, it's in a free flow. So if you understand and do not disturb this free flowing process, then the weight or the impact of this external action or the emotion comes down drastically, which will help you to handle things in an easier manner. And obviously it will slowly die down on its own. We cannot prescribe or identify a specific timeline for that, but it depends on how freely or how fast, how freely you can allow this, and how are you not disturbing this entire flow or the system of thoughts. So that will be the best.
Okay. It does not die there. What happens is the work continues. He also comes to the workplace. I also go to the workplace. Both of us see each other. Both of us get the same tense feeling. Of course, not that much level, but maybe a lesser level. But both of us know, look in a different direction. Is this okay?
So again, here there are two aspects. One is the external action. So external action, obviously there are no specific rules or something that we can follow. It depends on your situation, because you are the driver in that situation. So you will be a best judge to see how best you can handle that situation in the external action, right? Because, for example, if you really want to settle or compromise with him, then you have to definitely go for a compromise and do some, settle the issue mutually between among you, both of you, right? So that's on the external side. So you are free to choose, because the options will be only limited. If you see in the external world, the options will be limited. Either you can come to a compromise, you can come to a mutual understanding, settling the dispute, whatever, or you can take him back, whatever. Those three, four options, even if you are not clear or if you do not know what options to is the best option for you, you can take advice from the experts or your well-wishers, etc. So the external action is limited. Whoever is in this situation, even if I was in this situation, I will also have to follow only those, I will also have only those three or four options to execute. So depending on my knowledge and the situation, I will take one of the options. So that is very limited. So that is kind of easier to handle the external part. The problem is, because of the struggle and the conflict and the heaviness that we have in the inside, in the psychological system, we are kind of acting in a haphazard manner. We don't know where to, you know, what to do where. So we are struggling here. All our energy is getting drained inside because of handling this emotion or fighting against this emotion. So we are not in a balanced state of mind. Because of this whole drama or the struggle that is going on inside, we are not able to focus clearly on the external action. So once this internal system is clear, then you can take whatever is the best action possible for that situation. That's how I will recommend.
I hope this works very well to me. I am very happy with this answer. Okay.
Thank you.
I've got a question. Here new concept is introduced. Psychological world and physical world. Of course, it is new. We have to understand and pick it up. You please explain on that. But before that, we also were introduced a concept on conscious mind and subconscious mind. What is the relation between these two? I think if you can explain, that will be helpful to us.
Yeah. So let us come one by one. So first of all these concepts about external world, internal world, conscious mind, unconscious, superconscious, whatever it is. So the objective of all these concepts is only to understand the whole functioning of the mind. So the objective of all this is only to understand the functioning of the mind. That is the core objective. So for example, in cricket matches you must have seen there is a slow motion, right? So what is the object? Because it is not the actual play. The play has already happened. They will replay the actual scenario in a slow motion so that you can easily, slowly the ball will pass. You can easily see what is exactly happening. So the referee will be able to judge. So basically that is what is happening. You are actually doing a zoom in into the whole situation, because in reality the whole situation is happening in lightning, in a fast manner. So what we are trying to do is, by separating or dividing these into various forms, we are kind of trying to zoom in into that, trying to zoom in and trying to understand. So once we understand, you have to again zoom back. You cannot keep, in reality, during the actual action is happening, you cannot keep zooming in and trying out and testing out. That is not possible. What we are doing is, prior to the actual getting into the action, we are just trying to understand. That's the whole thing. So here, so all these, the subconscious mind and the conscious mind, etc. So subconscious mind, I think, as we have explained, is something which is which is the nature of everyone, because it is like, it is inbuilt, or which is formed by various conditions or opinions of your own or opinions of others, etc. And then whatever is appearing or getting expressed outside is called as conscious mind, that we've already seen. And this external internal bifurcation is only needed just to understand and split the problem, so that we can look at it, and then you can understand the problem in an easy way. That's the whole objective. But there is definitely, both of them are linked. It is not that external problem will definitely trigger an internal, an emotion inside the psychological system, according to the surroundings of the external, the problem that we are in, and according to the mindset or the nature of that person, it will definitely trigger an emotion. So that is quite perfectly fine, because that is the job of the conscious mind. Whatever situation happens, it should trigger some reaction inside. So based on that reaction, so we are free to act on our own. We can either use that reaction, and if it is really useful, we can use that to perform our external actions as a drive. Because if you don't have any drive, we will not perform any actions, right? So you can use that to perform your external actions. But if there is no action needed, then it is just a flowing thought, is just a flowing passing train. So there is nothing you need to do actually there.
okay, fine. Here it is a practical problem. I need a solution and answer for it. In my house, I mean, when I am in the house, I am most fearful. I am afraid of things there with the family members, say particularly my wife. But at the same time, when I go to office, staff and other people are afraid of me. I am wondering, I being the same person, I have not changed even my uniform also. Okay, what the uniform I started in my home, the same dress I have come to the office, but the situation have got changed. I am wondering it. What is it and how we can resolve this problem?
Okay. So here, if you see, though the person, when you say you are the same, only the physical person is the same, but the image you carry at home and the image you carry at office are two different, because there in home you feel that you don't have any control, or you feel that you're lacking some control, etc. So maybe the other partner is overpowering you or having a better control over you, maybe that's why you feel fear inside. But in the office, maybe you are the boss there, so you are free to exercise your control there. Maybe that's why you are angry and yelling at others. So it is just the change of the kind of image that you carry everywhere. So how to sort out the problem? Actually, I will say this is not a problem, because that is how you are carrying your image. Only thing is, if you don't give weightage, or if you are not too much bothered about this image, basically, because if you give weightage and start, because you start fighting against it, right? Because this is your natural flow. This is how it is happening for you. So I'm not talking about the external actions. There you can always, if you're yelling and if you find it troublesome for you, because if your character, if you find it troublesome for doing your office work, then definitely you can correct that external portion of it. You can probably be more patient, try to be more patient and understand them, and all that you can do. And similarly at home, if it is causing fear to you and because of that you are getting into trouble, then you can understand, you know, you can discuss and see what can be done in the external world at home. So that is the external part is concerned. But in the internal system, there is an image, that is your natural flow, that is how you are functioning naturally. So if you now start contradicting this natural flow, you will only start fighting against your own, right? Because you already have an image, now you are saying, I don't want an image. So these are two opposing thoughts. So mind versus mind. So again, that same clash will continue. So you are fighting against your own. So there is nobody can win in this situation. It is not a win-win situation, because when you are fighting against your own, you definitely cannot win. So the only possibility is understand the whole structure of mind and understand what is your role in the psychological system. And once you understand that all these thoughts are already flowing freely, and allow that, you know, without disturbing the entire flow, then, and if you don't give importance to these images, etc., obviously it should slow down and it will lose its importance, because it is in your image, it is in your mind that you carry, that I should have this image or I should not have this image, or that idea is strongly residing. So once you allow this thought to flow freely, then that idea will also slowly subside, and these images can also subside slowly.
Okay, fine. Yeah, I'm living in a family with my children. In fact, looking at them, we are really happy, living along with them happy. I think because of them, I'm getting happiness. When I analyze myself, it gave me an information or gave me an understanding that my happiness is not from them. It became a surprise point to me. Up to the morning, say, up to the yesterday, can be clear with. I had an idea that I am getting a happiness because of them. But today the understanding is totally different. I'm unable to understand this. Can you please explain?
Okay, sure. Yeah, it is right that the external action is not actually, it is only triggering the whole thing in your system. Because if you consider you know, anybody in your family or somebody doing an act, performing an action, two people will not take that same act, consider that same action and react in the same way, right? One person, for the same action, one person may feel happy about it, one person may not feel happy about it, or one person may feel maybe less happier about it, things like that. There are qualitative differences, right? So it is not an objective thing that if this is the action performed, this is what, you know, this is the reaction it will create. No, it will create, the reaction will be dependent on the, how, you know, what is the, what are the concepts that we have, and how far, what are the, how do we consider that as, depending on our expectations and the demands that we have placed, for example, on my son. What do I expect him to do? What do I expect him not to do? So based on so many other things, it brings happiness. For example, if he does something which I don't expect him to do, you know, for example, if he's smoking, I don't want him to smoke, then obviously it will create an unhappy or a pain in my system. Or if he does what I like to do, for example, if he goes for a singing or whatever it is, then that will create a happiness, or it will create a positive emotion in me. So it depends on the person who's involved, you know, person's psychological demands or whatever concepts that he has. So the external event is only a trigger switch. So you just switch on the, you know, put on the switch, then the bulb actually glows here, because we are connected from that switch, because we think that this is my son or this is my daughter, whatever it is. There is a connection between the switch and the light which is glowing here. So since this is connected, we consider this as part of me. Anything favorable happens in the external event, there is a switch on, then the light glows. Anything unfavorable happening in the external event, maybe the switch is off, the light doesn't glow. So that's what is happening. That is the connection between the external and the internal event. So that's how, but you are actually the light or the happiness or the sorrow, whatever is happening only here in your psychological system, depending on your own conditions and concepts and so many things that you have in mind.
Okay. I've been suffering on this problem for, say, more than a decade. So far, I have not found any solution on this. I'm looking a good solution from you. So far as me is concerned, I have got the things under my control, say in the office, in my surroundings, at my home. All activities go as per my wish. Nothing goes wrong against me. Everything comes under my control easily, without any difficulty. Everything goes as per my thinking. I am doing the work, I am surviving like this for more than a decade, as I told you. But so far as within, that is my mind, is concerned, I'm not able to have any control on this. If I want happiness, I'm not able to command. The sorrow comes, I'm not able to rub it out. Some old memory comes, I'm not able to throw it out. So it is very surprised when I am able to control such a big place, having, say, some 1,000 employees, such a big house, so many surroundings around, such a small mind, hardly any place, I'm not able to win even a single portion of it. I'm very surprised. So I'm looking for an answer for this.
So let's look at this problem in two aspects again. You said you're able to control, you're having a good control in your office environment or at your house or anywhere in the external world, right? See, first of all, external world is just an artificial system that we have created, right? So we have created some rules and regulations. For example, in office, you have certain rules. You're following some regulations, etc. And probably you have the power, you may be the boss in your office or something like that. So based on those situations, because you understand the rules and regulations correctly, you're able to control, you know, have control over everybody. And similarly in the house, you know, maybe you have power, more power over others, and you're able to control things as per how you want to organize in your house. So this is more of an external entity. So it only depends on So it doesn't matter. It only actually depends on whoever is powerful will definitely have better control. So probably from what you say, I think maybe you are the most powerful in your office and at home as well. So that is just a simple, whoever is powerful will have control over this, over the situation. That's the natural phenomena, right? That's how it happens, because we are all in a competitive environment. We are all existing in a competitive environment. Everybody is competing against each other in the external world. So whoever is fittest will have the better control, will have the stronger control, will survive. That's what, that is how it, that is the principle we operate in, right? So when it comes to the internal system, it is totally different here. So the problem is, we seem to have borrowed ideas or some conditioning which has gone into our mind, either through some concepts, either we have heard some from some gurus or through books or somebody else, that you know, you should always keep your mind in a happy state, or you should not be in a sorrow, a sad state, and these kind of things. It has all caused confusion in us. So the problem, so we have to understand this functioning of the mind completely, right? That is the, and then because since before, without understanding that, if you start putting your expectations and demands, so obviously there will be a clash, because you think that this is a situation, in a given situation, you want, you are expecting a certain kind of emotion. For example, if you are, for example, appearing for an exam, you want an emotion to be, you want positive, confident, you know, all those emotions, and you don't want negative, not confident, those kind of emotions. Or if you are in a family life, you want honest, truthfulness, sincerity, loyalty, and you don't want emotions like conflict, or you know, all those things, or negative emotions. So we have, based on our intellect, based on our knowledge, or from borrowed knowledge from books or wherever it is, we have formed an opinion, we have formed a set of rules, kind of, we have formed a rule book. You know, if this is the situation, these 1, 2, 3 is the emotion that I'm expecting, and these 1, 2, 3 emotions should not come, and this is the situation, 1, 2, 3 emotions is what should come, and these 1, 2, 3 emotions should not come. So we have kind of formed an opinion about all these things without even understanding the basis of the functioning of the mind. So when you have an expectation about the mind, and when the mind is not functioning according to your expectation, there is a gap. So mind is following its natural flow, whereas you have an expectation, different expectation. So obviously this gap needs to be bridged. Otherwise there will be always a clash, because if the mind reacts in a way that you don't expect it to react, then you will obviously keep fighting against it. So the only solution is, we have to understand the functioning of the mind, how it flows freely, how thought flows, what is exactly happening, and how thoughts flow one by one in a sequence, and what is our role in the mind, and what can we do, what control we have. So if you understand all that, then you will realize that the mind is, then you will not at least have unnatural or artificial expectations, because once you understand the functioning of the mind, you will not come up with an expectation which is different from this, which is completely opposite from this. That's the whole point. So the problem here is the expectation that you have formed. So for that, the remedy is, you have to understand the mind and see whether your expectations are really correct, because you have just gathered it from somebody. It's a borrowed knowledge from somebody. So the expectations, you have to revalidate and relook at the expectations. So that's the solution for this problem.
I was looking for an answer for an interesting event I was facing in for quite a long time. See, I go to a new place, a strange place. I see a child, say maybe around 1 year or 1.5 years, like that. I get happiness very nicely without even touching the child. Child may be staring at me, child may be crying looking at me, but still I get happiness. And most of the people do the same thing. They all become happy, they smile looking at the child. Whereas the persons nearby, maybe they are very fashionably dressed or whatever, maybe latest looking, but we don't find any happiness with them. It surprised to me,
We have gone to a new place, nobody is known. For a child, we have become very happy. For others, we have become unhappy. What could be the reason? I was thinking for quite longer time. At some point of time, I got an answer. Maybe see, after attending this class here. In this class, it was told, all the children are liberated ones. That means we unknowingly like the liberated persons automatically. You take any liberated person like Vivekananda, Ramakrishna, so many other people, including our Bhagavatayya. Automatically the happiness comes. They have not done anything to us, but we feel happiness with them by looking at them. So I find this is the answer, that a child which is liberated one gives the happiness as good as a liberated person is. So I think we should learn from the child this concept that we should aim for the liberation. Thank you very much. Hi, this is Babulal. I want to share with you something what I have learned. We are doing so many works outside, depending upon our profession. Everybody would like to do the work in a better way. Everybody loves it and likes it also. So a question comes, how we can do? So the latest knowledge, updation of knowledge, equipments, machineries, definitely gives an improvement, no doubt about it. Even we attend some classes to get the latest information and technologies. But nevertheless, we find several times our efficiency had come down because of primarily negative emotions. We say, I got angry, I became tension, like that, I got fear, hence I could not do it in a better way. That seems to be a practical thing which happens. Now the question arises, if we can control over that, our performance on the work would be better. So how do we control over that? So now we need to examine for a solution for this. See, we are performing our activity based on our mind. The mind is the root cause or the important element which helps us in doing the work always. So in order to see this thing in a better form, we will do a simple analysis of the mind. For this purpose, we will divide the mind into two portions. This division is based on its function. One is conscious mind, another is subconscious mind. The conscious mind primarily consists of intellect. The intellect, the prime function of this intellect is for decision making. For any given situation, it decides based on the input what it gets. Even certain positions, certain situations, for making a decision, if it needs information or data, it collects, it understands and takes a decision. This is the typical characteristic of intellect. Once you start doing the activities like that, executing the work like that, it obviously works for winning the situation outside. So, by making decisions, it aims for the winning of the decisions. Using this intellect, obviously we know that we develop our systems, improvements, etc. has been done. Say for a building, for making a building, you want to go for a building, new building. You will visualize, design, procure material. All this thing analysis is done by this intellect, and by using this switch, you get the good result. Now, this is one portion of the mind that is intellect, conscious mind. Now, the other portion, the second portion, it is subconscious mind. Subconscious mind primarily has got emotional contents. That means it releases the emotions based on the situation or the nature of the persons. Sometime it can be fear, sometime it can be angry, sometime it can be joy, sometime it can be happiness. The important parameter on this subconscious mind is it cannot be controlled. It does not obey to anybody. In other words, what we can say in a simpler term is, if one wants to be in an angry mood for whole day, we know it is just not possible. So now the mind, we have seen one portion of it who decides the thing, and another portion gives away the emotions. Now let us come to a situation where we are doing the work. The work is not going well. When the work is not going well, obviously some negative emotions will arise. From the conscious mind, you will get a negative emotions. Say like maybe unhappy, maybe tension, or whatever it is, it will come up. Now, this intellect, what it does is, it has been taking a decision, external work, correcting the external work. Now it starts looking at these fears and tension also. It thinks that it can control those things easily. Like other areas, outside areas, it controls. It thinks that it can control this also. Now we know subconscious mind cannot be controlled by anybody. Now for a given situation, intellect comes to the subconscious mind to control on that. Now it has become a very funny situation that two portions of the mind tries to control one or the other. That is basically in mind is split in two. And in this condition, what will be the effectiveness of the work that will be done? The mind has to be in a single unit to get a good throughput, whereas the actual condition is this. This is the real problem that every one of us faces. Now the question which arises is, can we come out of this? Is there any possibility? Then we need to understand a little more, we'll examine further on this. In order to have an understanding of this, we need to have an idea about the emotions which comes. The emotion which comes, the life of the emotion which comes is very, 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 very small. Hardly much smaller than a second. That means when the intellect wants to stop or wants to throw away this anger, more anger comes because of the resistance to conscious mind. The life of the emotions which are coming is very less, and that also it goes away. I mean, on that situation, the role of intellect, nothing can be done. It is able to do only resisting that. The more the resistance, the more emotions are coming up. If intellect understands the life of these emotions are almost negligible and that too it flies away, then it will not look inside. Same intellect has acquired so much of knowledge, say, for doing a work. It has picked up, even we also, simply in our life. We have learned so many things, even after our school days. There was a time where computer is not there. Now nobody lives without a computer. Okay, so that means we all have acquired this knowledge by understanding. Now this understanding of the emotion does not have a long life and it just flies away. The moment this intellect understands this, then it does not look inside. Then it starts focusing his attention to outside, obviously. Then the whole mind starts working as a single unit. Once the intellect starts working towards outside, the emotion which comes from inside ably supports the intellect. That means, so far as the outside work is concerned, intellect as well as emotion both work together to improve the outside situation. This is how we can improve our work content is concerned. I think this should be a good input for you for betterment. In spiritual terms, this understanding that intellect cannot lay his hand on emotions is called enlightenment. And the emotions which flow out is called pravagam. Thank you very much.